Thank you. I would ask all those members who are leaving the chamber to please do so quickly and quietly, as we will now move on to the next item of business. And the next item of business is a debate on motion 12922 in the name of Angela Constance on Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill at Stage 1. I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance to speak to and to move the motion. Up to 14 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I open this debate with thanks to the Criminal Justice Committee for their Stage 1 report on the Victims, Witness and Justice Reform Bill. It represents comprehensive scrutiny over many months of an important bill which aims to improve the experience of victims whilst protecting the rights of the accused. I welcome that the committee took evidence from victims and survivors and did so in a way which supported them to tell their story and be part of improving the justice system. And I thank everyone who gave evidence to the committee, but I give particular mention to the victims and survivors who, quite rightly, are at the centre of the bill and the process of reform. I want to reflect on why this bill is needed. Scotland's justice system has evolved over centuries. Similarly, our definitions of what is criminal behaviour has changed over the years, reflecting changes in societal attitudes. These two elements go hand in hand. Our system must be capable of delivering justice for victims of all crimes and of adapting where it is not serving us well. No part of our justice system should be exempt from scrutiny. While there have been positive, iterative reforms over the years, the committee has heard compelling evidence that for many, the process of justice is just as traumatic as the crime itself, or where a case results in a verdict which has no definition and cannot be explained to the victim or the accused, it can feel like there has been no justice. That is simply not good enough. The bill proposes a package of reforms which responds to the views and concerns shared by victims and survivors. It is informed by the work of the Victims Task Force, Lady Dorian's review into improving the management of sexual offence cases, and by independent large-scale jury research. We want to deliver a system where victims are treated with compassion and their voices are heard, which meets the needs of survivors of sexual offences, the majority of whom are women and girls, and which is a more modern and transparent at enhancing public confidence. Presiding Officer, I am pleased that the Criminal Justice Committee supports the general principles of this bill. I welcome the committee's recognition of justice agencies' commitment to trauma-informed practice, alongside an acknowledgement that more needs to be done to embed this across the system. The bill creates a statutory definition of trauma-informed practice and introduces a requirement for justice agencies to set standards for and report on trauma-informed practice. The bill will strengthen ongoing non-legislative work, including the Knowledge and Skills Framework, which was introduced last year. The committee heard from many witnesses that legislation is key in this regard. As Lady Dorian said, it will provide the impetus towards creating the necessary culture change. The bill also recognises that civil proceedings can also cause trauma. It enhances protection for vulnerable parties and witnesses in civil cases by extending the use of special measures and by protecting people who have suffered abuse from being cross-examined by their abuser. The bill seeks to reduce trauma and improve experiences through the creation of two new automatic rights for victims of sexual crime. The right to anonymity for victims of sexual and certain other offences is particularly important in today's social media age. It will help protect victims' privacy and dignity and may increase the confidence of victims to report offending. The publicly funded right to independent legal representation for complainers when requests are made to lead evidence about their sexual history or character is a substantial change to a deeply intrusive aspect of sexual offence cases. It will mean that a complainer is recognised as a party in the proceedings in respect of such applications, helping to ensure they understand the process and that their voice is heard. Presiding Officer, I very much welcome the committee's view that the not proven verdict has had its day. It is a verdict that is not defined or well understood, and which can lead to confusion and trauma for victims and stigma for the accused. The bill will abolish not proven in all criminal cases and retain the widely understood verdicts of guilty and not guilty. Now, I recognise that the bill raises challenging issues and that some proposals were not supported by the committee. And this includes the jury reforms that accompany the removal of the not proven verdict. The bill proposes to reduce the number of jurors in a criminal trial from 15 to 12 and change the size of the majority required for a conviction from a simple majority to two-thirds. The Scottish Government's position is based on the evidence that suggests that moving to two verdicts while retaining a simple majority will lead to an increase in convictions in finely balanced cases. No other similar jurisdiction in the world considers it appropriate for convictions to be based on a simple majority decision. The evidence also tells us that groups of 12 deliberate more effectively than groups of 15. However, Presiding Officer, we have always recognised that a range of experts have differing views on what reforms, if any, should accompany the abolition of the not proven verdict. And I respect that the committee came to a different conclusion than what is proposed in the bill, and I will think carefully about the issues that committee has raised.
Yes. John Spinney.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way and also for the remarks she's just placed on the record, because this is a very significant issue. In her further consideration, will she also take into account the requirement that the Scottish jurisdiction requires for corroboration, which is a significant material factor in influencing the judgment that she has to make in relation to the content of the proposal that is brought forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, we will of course consider the debate in and around the jury majority with sensitivity, with depth. We will look at all the relevant issues and engage with all relevant stakeholders in this regard. This is an area of the bill that involves finely balanced judgments. We do need to proceed in a manner that we all work together, but also give careful but deep consideration. And I do reiterate, one, the importance of this part of the bill, but also reiterate that the Government will indeed reflect in detail on the wide range of comments that committee has scrutinised. Presiding Officer, the proposed Victims and Witnesses Commissioner will provide an independent voice for victims and witnesses, champion their views and help ensure their interests are at the heart of the justice system. I note that committee's reservations, particularly around resource and the impact on victim support organisations. However, I believe this role can be established in a way that is cost efficient and can enhance the work of support organisations rather than diminish or duplicate their efforts. During the evidence sessions, lack of accountability was an issue that kept being raised. No existing public body or organisation has the statutory power to hold justice agencies to account in relation to how the rights of victims and witnesses are met or upheld. Nor can this role be given to a third sector organisation. The Commissioner will provide that accountability. Presiding Officer, I now turn to parts of the bill that focus on sexual offences and where there are mixed views. Both Lady Dorian and Lord Advocate emphasised that we need to make seismic structural, statutory changes to ensure victims and survivors have meaningful access to justice. The Bill does this through the creation of a new National Sexual Offences Court. Complainers' experiences will be improved through greater use of pre-recorded evidence, better judicial case management and mandatory trauma-informed training for all involved in the court. A new and distinct court will bring about the necessary shifts in culture, practice and procedure. Cases will be brought to trial more quickly through more efficient use of existing court and judicial resources, helping to reduce delay, which is a significant cause of distress and trauma for complainers. Victims cannot afford for us to rely on the historical status and structure of the existing court system to deliver changes that we all agree are needed and which the status quo has singularly failed to deliver. If we fail to take ambitious action now, we risk consigning victims to unnecessary re-traumatisation through a court system that is not sufficiently specialised and focused on improving victims' experiences. This is a risk, Presiding Officer, that I'm not prepared to take. I recognise that the committee has concerns about certain aspects of the court, and I will work very hard with members and justice partners to address each one. Presiding Officer, the Bill enables a time-limited pilot of single-judge rape trials. The proposal for the pilot is informed by complainers' experiences of the trial process, by numerous studies on rape myths, and by the fact that conviction rate for rape is consistently lower than for other crimes. Soberingly, the new data based on management information from the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service that we have included in our response to Stage 1 report shows that for the kind of cases the pilot is intended to focus on, namely single charge, single complainer rape and attempted rape cases, the five-year average conviction rate is just 24%. The purpose of the pilot will provide much-needed evidence to let us have a properly informed debate on an enduring issue that undermines confidence in our criminal justice system. Now, I acknowledge that there are differences of opinion on both the court and the pilot, and I have and will reflect on that, as I have already done in the response to committee, and have intimated that I will be bringing forward amendments at Stage 2, and I will speak more about that in my closing remarks, Presiding Officer. But it is clear that our justice system needs to change the way in which it responds to serious sexual offending. As legislators, it is our role to determine the legal frameworks that ought to be in place, and no part of our justice system should be exempt from review and, if necessary, reconsideration. Yes, I do, I think so.
Christine Graham.
You know my position already about jurisdictional trials, so I won't reprise that, but can I just have a clarification? The proposal is for jurisdictional trials on a pilot for rape cases, not for serious sexual offences. I don't want the lines blurred. And just have that clarification.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, Presiding Officer, I can give that clarification to Ms Graham, that the pilot, whatever form it takes, is to look at rape and attempted rape cases, and I've already given commitments to committee to put more detail around the criteria and the operation of the pilot on the face of the bill. Presiding Officer, this bill has been shaped by cross-sector consideration and collaboration, and I am absolutely committed to taking the same approach as it progresses through Parliament. And I will work constructively across the Chamber with our stakeholders and partners and with victims and survivors to deliver the transformational change that is required. And I am sure members will approach the bill in the same spirit that we have thus far debated and discussed within the committee process to what I believe has been the highest possible standard. Presiding Officer, I know that the issues dealt with by this bill are significant and complex. As parliamentarians, we are making decisions which will have far-reaching consequences. But I believe the case for change is clear. I believe that the time for change is now, and it is incumbent on us to work together to deliver the justice system that our society needs and deserves. Given evidence to the committee, Lady Dorian said, if we do not seize the opportunity to create the culture change from the ground up, there is every risk that in 40 years, my successor and your successors will be in this room having the same conversation. Signing officers, I will continue to work with members and invite them to work with me on this landmark bill, and I move the motion in my name. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Audrey Nicholl to speak on behalf of the Criminal Justice Committee. Up to 13 minutes, please, Ms Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm very pleased to speak in this afternoon's debate on behalf of the Criminal Justice Committee. So firstly, I want to extend the committee's sincere thanks to the Clerks team, who worked tirelessly to support members in a significant piece of work, and to SPICE and PACT colleagues, who also supported the committee throughout our consideration of the bill at Stage 1. Our Stage 1 report has been a major piece of work for the committee, and from the outset we were clear that we needed to take the necessary time to consider the bill in a thorough and balanced way. So beginning in September last year, we took 36 hours of oral evidence over 14 separate meetings. We received 262 responses to our call for views and heard from 64 different witnesses, and our report is 200 pages long. Not everyone will agree with all our conclusions, but we made sure that we heard all sides of the arguments on the main issues. Throughout our report, we refer to the important evidence we heard from survivors of sexual crime. And I would like to thank all those survivors who gave evidence. Their evidence was powerful and invaluable in helping members shape our thinking about the bill. And I want to start my contribution with the words of one of these survivors, because it reminds us all of why this bill is so important. When we talk about what happened, each one of us mentions the exact date that our case went to trial. We remember the date that we were raped, but we also remember the date that we went to trial, because they are as traumatic as each other. And I would also like to acknowledge the constructive way that my fellow committee members worked together to scrutinise the bill, and as a result, a great majority of our report was agreed unanimously. So today I want to highlight the main conclusions and recommendations reached by the committee. I will leave it to others to comment on the Scottish Government response to our report. However, I do want to thank the Cabinet Secretary for her constructive engagement with the committee throughout Stage 1 and her willingness to consider changes to the bill following our recommendations. So turning firstly to Part 1 of the bill, the proposal for a Victims and Witnesses Commissioner. We heard evidence about the potential benefits of establishing the commissioner post. The commissioner could champion the voices of victims and witnesses, highlight areas of concern to policymakers, and promote good practice. However, as a committee, we also heard about the wider implications of creating a new commissioner post. These are costs associated with another commissioner at a time when public finances are under significant pressure. We also heard concerns that the commissioner could be another layer of bureaucracy and stand in the way of victims and advocacy groups engaging directly with policy makers. Overall, we remained to be convinced that a strong case has been made for the establishment of the commissioner, and instead better outcomes may be achieved by focusing spending on areas with a more direct benefit for victims and witnesses. And if a commissioner post is established, we recommend it should be for a time-limited period to allow for an assessment to be made of the value of the role. Part 2 of the bill proposes embedding trauma-informed practice in the criminal justice system, and as a committee we support this objective. Some of the evidence from survivors about the trauma they experienced arising from their treatment in the justice system was truly shocking to hear. We made several recommendations about how this part of the bill could be improved. So, for example, the definition of trauma-informed practice should be strengthened to bring it in line with the knowledge and skills framework created by NHS Education for Scotland. We concluded that training in trauma-informed practice should be extended to include defence lawyers and judges participating in all court proceedings. Whilst recognising the independence of the judiciary, we recommend that court rules should require that court proceedings must be conducted in line with trauma-informed practice. And we noted that legislation is not necessarily required to deliver improvements, with survivors highlighting improvements that could and should be delivered now. Turning to part four of the bill, which proposes to remove the verdict of not proven in criminal cases and reduce the size of juries from 15 to 12, with a majority for a guilty verdict set at 8. These are fundamental reforms of great significance to the criminal justice system. And on the basis of the evidence we heard, we concluded that the not proven verdict has had its day and should be abolished. We do not think it is satisfactory to have a verdict which has no accepted legal definition and cannot be explained to a jury. Furthermore, we heard compelling evidence about the devastating impact which the verdict can have on victims and sometimes the accused. The proposed changes to jury size and majorities are designed to balance the system, as the Scottish Government believes that abolishing the not proven verdict will make convictions more likely. However, we receive contradictory evidence as to whether these balancing changes were in fact needed. Notably, the Lord Advocate told us the proposed changes were very concerning, and it was her view that acquittals could increase as a result. So this left us in a difficult position when it came to drawing conclusions given these conflicting views. Ultimately, while we supported the abolition of the not proven verdict, we did not hear compelling, convincing evidence to support the balancing changes proposed by the Scottish Government to jury size and majorities in the bill. Nor, unfortunately, did we hear convincing evidence in support of any specific alternatives proposed by others. So, as such, we agree that the not proven verdict should be abolished and that further thinking needs to be done on what else, if anything, is required. So turning now to part five of the bill, which proposes the establishment of a new sexual offences court. The court would have the power to deal with a wide range of serious sexual offences, including rape and other charges appearing on the indictment, including murder, and its jurisdiction would extend across the whole of Scotland. Some members supported the proposals of a new sexual offences court. For those members, the model of a new sexual offences court has the potential to deliver improvements in the handling of sexual offences cases which cannot be realised using existing mechanisms. Other members did not support a standalone sexual offences court. Their view is that it would be possible to achieve the necessary improvements through the creation of a sexual specialist division of the High Court and the Sheriff Court. Despite this difference of views, we agreed a series of recommendations to enhance the proposals in the bill. For example, we made recommendations about the levels of legal representation which should apply in the new court. We think it is important that there is no perception that the sexual offences court lacks seriousness or solemnity. And we also recommended that the Scottish Government amends the bill so that any case involving murder can only be tried in the High Court as it is now. So turning now to the proposal to proposal to pilot a judge-only trials for rape cases without a jury. This has been a very controversial proposal on which there has been considerable debate, and in our report we set out in detail the wide range of views we received. Ultimately, different members of the committee reached different conclusions as to whether the pilot should go ahead and under what conditions. And these positions are set out in detail in the report. We did, however, make a series of recommendations which were all agreed by members. We recommend that more details about the criteria for assessing the pilot should be included on the face of the bill. Any regulations brought forward for a pilot should also be subject to more detailed consultation and parliamentary scrutiny, with time allowed for detailed consideration of draft regulations. We also recommended that the Scottish Government should amend the bill to make it clear that the pilot could only be run once. And finally, we highlighted the idea that an alternative to a single judge trial would be a panel of judges. So I've given a short summary of some of the committee's main recommendations, and I would also refer members to our conclusions on other parts of the bill. Part 3 of the bill, which expands the availability of special measures in civil cases. Part 6 of the bill, which provides for independent legal representation for complainers when applications are made under Rape Shield provisions, and the provisions for automatic statutory anonymity for various sexual and related offences. In summary, we supported these provisions in principle. However, we made some recommendations for improvement to the details in the bill. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, while the committee is content to agree the general principles of the bill at stage one, further improvements can be made. Although committee members did not support every proposal in the bill, we all recognise it has the potential to improve the justice system for victims and witnesses, and this is something that we wholly support. For some members, the final composition of the bill at stage three will ultimately determine whether they feel able to support it. In the meantime, we stand ready to give the bill our detailed scrutiny at stage two. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Nicol. I now call on Russell Finlay. Up to 10 minutes, please, Mr Finlay.
Thank you, President Officer. I begin by thanking the Justice Committee team for their assistance, not least the unseen work of the eternally patient researchers and clerks. Committee members rely on witnesses sharing their insights, experiences and expertise, and particular recognition should be given to victims, including survivors of sexual violence, who waived their anonymity to deliver powerful and compelling testimony. Now, according to the title, this bill is ostensibly about victims. Members may not know that its working title was the Criminal Justice Reform Bill. The bill is mainly about justice reform, as the original name had it. It's a vehicle to deliver some of the most profound changes to Scotland's criminal justice system, perhaps for centuries. Now, some might like to describe these as bold and radical, but I believe much of it is experimental, founded on wishful thinking rather than hard evidence. It's unlikely that many members will have read our Stage 1 report, all 205 pages of it, but I would like to attempt to summarise. The bill is in six parts, and before I come to each, I believe that one of the most important overarching issues is that this bill is frankly far too big. The government has a track record of bad law, clunky, confusing, unworkable. Parliament cannot allow this to continue. And in that vein, I'm encouraged by media reports of some SNP members being willing to stand up and be counted today. Now, part one of the bill would create the role of a commissioner for victims and witnesses. On the face of it, what's not to like? Fighting for the rights of victims and witnesses, a champion for those afflicted by crime, and justice system failures, except the Commissioner would not be able to become involved in individual cases. So what is the point? Does Scotland's public sector really need yet another hugely expensive functionary producing reams of jargon? Now, committee members were unpersuaded by the government's proposal for a commissioner, and this was unanimous. Now, part two of the bill requires some criminal justice agencies to, quote, have regard, end quote, for what is called trauma-informed practice. Now, having spent months talking about and listening to people talking about trauma-informed practice, I'm still no clearer on its exact definition. Our Stage 1 report raised numerous concerns, including the observation that, quote, legislation is not necessarily required to deliver improvements. And I believe that is a significant understatement. For far too long, victims and witnesses have been disrespected. A lack of basic compassion, courtesy and communication often causes great distress. If you just look at the ordeals of the seven women who appeared in the recent BBC disclosure documentary Surviving Domestic Abuse, they don't want legislative platitudes. And it's notable that some justice organisations who back trauma-informed practice have a track record of failing victims. If we just look at the new report by His Majesty's Prosecution Inspector, Laura Payton, she says that many of her 27 recommendations relate to matters that are already required but have yet not been routinely delivered by the Crown Office. Part three of the bill would introduce special measures in civil court cases. Again, on the face of it, this is largely agreeable. But as our Stage 1 report points out, legislation relating to special measures has still not come into force 4 years after being passed by Parliament. I raised what is known as legal system abuse with the Cabinet Secretary. That's where abusers, mostly men facing criminal proceedings, simultaneously weaponise the civil courts to inflict further trauma. I put a simple fix to the Cabinet Secretary to have the same sheriff preside over connected criminal and civil cases. I think her response was lukewarm, but this is a practical measure that could make a real difference. Part four of the bill calls for the abolition of not proven. Yes, I will.
Christine Graham.
I thank the member for the tone and his thoughtful contribution, and there you are. But that already happened when I was in practice many moons ago as a civil practitioner, is that when there was a criminal matter involved with one of the parties, quite often the same sheriff sat in the civil proceedings as the criminal. So it's not inventing, it's nothing new.
Rosa Finlay.
I thank the member for her intervention, and I've dialed down my flamboyance for her today. I agree. I think that speaks to the point, which is a recurring theme, which is much of what could be done can be done without legislation. Now, the not proven verdict came into being entirely by accident, not by design. It does not exist in any comparable jurisdiction. It is an acquittal, no different to not guilty, but it has no legal definition. Countless victims and surviving relatives have been devastated by this verdict. Now, a guilty verdict can only be returned where the Crown Office proves its case beyond reasonable doubt. If they have not done so, then an acquittal must follow. I therefore do not see how outcomes would be altered by the removal of not proven. Now, this brings me to another provision in Part 4, which the government thinks is needed alongside the abolition of not proven. They want to reduce the size of juries from 15 to 12, which is consistent with international comparable jurisdictions. The existing system allows for a guilty verdict on the basis of a simple majority, that being 8 of 15. But the government seeks to change this to a two-thirds majority for conviction, that being 8 of 12. Now, this proposal appears to please no one. Defence lawyers say it's inconsistent with international practice, where either unanimity or 10 or 11 of 12 is required. Yet the Lord Advocate would like the bill amended to include a provision for retrial in the event of 7 of 12 jurors believing an accused is guilty. The committee is not convinced that abolishing the not proven verdict necessitates the need for changes to juries. Members agreed unanimously that the evidence is not there. Now, part 5 of the bill would create a new sexual offences court. Not a new court, but existing courts with a different sign on the door. Now, one concern of the committee is that the new court might result in a perceived downgrading in the treatment of sex crimes. Another is that these courts could also hear cases of murder, where charges of sexual nature are also on the indictment. In response, the government says it's considering stage 2 amendments, and I look forward to seeing the detail. Part 6 would give automatic lifelong anonymity for sex crime victims. It's tribute to Scotland's news media that this right has long been respected by convention alone. But while we support this, there are unresolved issues relating to potential criminalisation of free speech. And Part 6 also give complainers in sex crime cases the right to legal representation in specifically defined circumstances. And this is another proposal that seems to be instinctively agreeable, but there are concerns about the financial cost and fears of the unintended consequences of potentially adding to delays for victims. Now, I end on the government's single most contentious proposal, which is to scrap jurors in rape trials, some rape trials. This would be a departure from the long-established right of a person accused of serious crime to a trial by a jury of their peers. We believe in the value of juries, which are the cornerstone of the justice system. They reflect wider society and comprise a diverse range of views and life experience. There's insufficient evidence to justify what would amount to an experiment with people's lives. One argument for this is that jurors, in other words, the Scottish public, are prone to believing so-called rape myths. But where's the evidence for this? Furthermore, it was only late last year that Scottish judges began to address jurors about rape myths, despite this being long-established practice elsewhere in the UK. We really need to see what impact this will have. And as much as they might want, ministers cannot wish away threats that these proceedings would be boycotted by lawyers. The Scottish Conservatives have other concerns about jurors' trials, which are set out in the Stage 1 report. But we find ourselves, Presiding Officer, in a difficult position today, a position of the government's making. My party's Holyrood manifesto contained a real victims' bill in the name of our next Speaker, Jamie Green. It also included abolition of not proven. But what's in front of us today is vast, unwieldy and complex. There is a lack of evidence. There are too many unanswered questions. It is experimental, perhaps even dangerously so. The government appears to be experimenting in much the same way as a mad scientist at work, with another committee member describing the bill as being like a Rubik's Cube. You fix one side and then you realise you've messed up the rest of it. It would be easy to vote no today, but we will instead abstain to send a very clear message to the government. This can be fixed. This must be fixed. They need to engage. They need to listen. And they really do need to think again. I thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Finlay. I now call Pauline McNeill. Up to 8 minutes, please, Ms. McNeill.
Thank you. And thank you sincerely to my colleagues on the Justice Committee and to the clerks for what I think is an excellent report outlined by the convener earlier. It is clear that we need transformative change in our justice system for victims and complainers when it comes to rape and sexual offences. And I, too, are really welcome the fact that we were able to engage so closely with victims who put themselves forward to speak to the Criminal Justice Committee. Scottish Labour supports the Government's aims that it is time for change, but we believe that they need a comprehensive plan to look separately at each reform contained within the bill. We believe there's too much substantial reform in one bill. We also believe that there is a lot that can be achieved without legislation. In fact, some of that change is already beginning to happen, such as giving evidence by a commission referred to by the Cabinet Secretary, a tightened application of Section 275 for rape trials. And the Lord Advocate herself has made a huge difference, I think we've heard, in the way in which victims are getting more access to their lawyers. And the judge is now required to charge a jury specifically on the question of rape myths. So all credit to all those involved in that. But listening to victims, it is clear that we need to break down the barriers. Yes, of course.
Yeah. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much. I wonder if Ms McNeill is aware of the Senator's written evidence when they say that even in response to the new jury directions, that juries were still regularly acquitting in cases where the judge believed that there was credible and reliable evidence for a conviction.
Polly McNeill.
Yes, I do acknowledge that, Cabinet Secretary, but I hope you would agree that some progress has been made, that judges are now expected in every case to talk about rape myths, and I really credit Rape Crisis and other organisations for making that happen. But listening to victims, it is clear that we need to break down the barriers that prevent them from telling their story in court and allowing more access to advocate deputies. We've heard from victims that they feel a bystander in their own trial, and we absolutely must fix that. We support the embedding of trauma-informed practices included in the bill, although, as the committee says, the scope of trauma-informed practice should be extended to all practitioners and the defence as well. But there must be a whole system approach towards working to make the system better for victims in our system. We talked about the single point of contact. It's quite clear to me that victims, in their pleadings with the Criminal Justice Committee, want a single point of contact, communication with the Crown, communication with advocate deputies in their case, and an understanding of what is going on in the trial that concerns them. We can do that without legislation. Delay is one of the biggest reasons that victims are really exercised about how the criminal justice system treats them. And I would point out, as I have many times, that even laws passed by this Parliament to try and prevent delay, specifying there should be criminal trials within 140 days, are excessively exceeded and have been for several years. We also support the anonymity of rape victims. However, most of the other changes proposed in the bill are still problematic, and I want to go through that in some detail. Scottish Labour opposes the use of juryless trials as set out in this bill. We find it concerning that the proposal is described as a pilot. Sheila Webster of the Law Society made the point that it's not truly a pilot because we're talking about live cases here. People's lives will be permanently affected at the end of the pilot, and we might decide it wasn't a very good idea. But one of the key issues as to what would constitute success, and I acknowledge that the Government has said they'll put this on the face of the bill, but we've been told that the Government are not designing a system specifically to increase conviction rates, but will still be assessing outcomes, which we'll assume will be including looking at conviction rates. Professor Chalmers told the Criminal Justice Committee in relation to the pilot that it would be surprising if conviction rates did not factor in the decision whether to go forward with the reform. And legal professionals have voiced their concerns that, in fact, despite the government's claims, the conviction rates are likely to be used as a marker of success. Yes. Yes, I will, yeah.
Rona Mackay.
Thank you for taking the intervention. Does the member believe that a 24% conviction rate in single rape cases is acceptable?
Polly McNeill.
No, I don't think it's acceptable. In case the member has misunderstood my point, the government has said that they don't specifically aim to increase conviction rates. They've said that throughout, but it's unclear of what the pilot will do when they measure success of outcomes. It's a very particular important point, and I'll come to the question of the low conviction rates. Simon Brown from the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association pointed out to the committee, if we drill down to the basics, the pilot is a response to the perception that the conviction rate is, if a rape trial is too low, and therefore any objective test of pilot can only be a success if it does increase conviction rates. If it doesn't increase conviction rates, he says, what is the point of it? So clearly we must have fair and balanced outcomes, and I do agree with the government it would be dangerous to specifically set out to reform a criminal justice system specifically to increase conviction rates. And I do believe I support Rona Mackay's assertions that the conviction rate is too low. But there is a lot of evidence that suggests to me that by supporting victims in court to tell their full story, it will lead to better quality evidence and more convictions. And nobody can tell me that that can be overturned. One of the key evaluators of the pilot, is there any time in hand?
There's a limited bit of time in hand, yes.
I'll take an intervention from Christine Green.
Christine Green.
Obliged, I'm not on the committee. I don't understand this particular section, which says section 65, subsection 1. The Scottish ministers may by regulations provide that trials and indictment for rape or attempted rape which meet specified criteria are for a specified period to be conducted by the court, city without a jury. What is or are that specified criteria?
Polly McNeill.
One of the things that the government have responded to, they're going to put on the face of the bill what the specified criteria is, and that's what I'm trying to speak to just now. I still have issues with it. So one of the examples would be the government have said that, so how single judge trials are perceived by those in the trial process will be one of the criteria. So you can see how that's very, very difficult to measure. I want to talk about the not proven verdict. Just lastly on jury trials. The fact that the government has now said that they don't intend to bring that forward in 2028 is of serious concern to Scottish Labour, because if the government's position is they think there is some benefit to having juryless trials, then they really should do within their own parliamentary term. We do support the removal of the not proven verdict. We believe it's had its day. However, a serious issue remains as to how we balance the system to ensure that we maintain a fair system. Now, I do think the government's place of where they come from in this is right. But I think the problem is here that suggesting a jury majority would remain a simple majority of one to convict, I think, is wrong. But I think the problem the government have is that there's no consensus now on what that majority would be. And one of the government's assertions, rightly so, is that Scotland is the only jurisdiction has a not proven verdict. We would be the only jurisdiction that doesn't, that has a 8-4-12 majority. On the specialist courts, and I know that I need to wind up, presiding officer, I mean, Scottish Labour have suggested to resolve the issues of rights of audience, which is a serious issue, especially for the accused in getting the balance here, that could be achieved by the High Court having a specific division and the Sheriff Court. As it stands, we cannot support these proposals. We think there's too much reform in one bill. We need to examine at stage two what of these reforms can really make a difference. I think the government have got a lot of work to do to convince us. We will be abstaining this evening, and if we can't resolve these issues at stage two, we will vote against the bill. It's really up to the government to show that they can resolve some of these outstanding issues.
Thank you, Ms McNeill. I now call on Liam MacArthur. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I greatly enjoyed my time on the Justice Committee in the last session, and oftentimes find myself missing it. But I don't envy Audrey Nicholl and her colleagues the task of scrutinising this very wide-ranging bill, but thank the Criminal Justice Committee sincerely for its diligent work, and add my own tribute, particularly to the survivors of rape and sexual assault, for sharing their experience and informing what I think is an excellent Stage 1 report. Can I also thank the Cabinet Secretary and her officials for the time taken to engage with me over the many issues arising from these reforms. We've not always agreed, but I'm grateful to the characteristically constructive way in which the Cabinet Secretary has gone about this task. Presiding Officer, this is a tricky bill to speak to, as others, I think, have alluded to. It's both expansive and it's complex. Complexity born not just of the number of provisions, but their variety, I think a point that Russell Finlay was making. It brings together recommendations of Lady Dorian's review alongside other changes. And matters are further complicated, of course, by the fact that important changes long demanded by women's groups and victims' groups have also recently been introduced, no, not by Parliament, but from the bench. In last year's Lord Advocate's reference, by overturning Smith against Leeds, the High Court appears to have overhauled the principle of corroboration as it applies to sexual offences. As a result, the situation facing Parliament now, as it considers the bill, is very different to that which applied when the bill was introduced, let alone when Lady Dorian came forward with her review. Of course, there are reforms in this bill that are needed, some would argue long overdue, and which enjoy pretty widespread support. For example, the introduction of independent legal representation for complainers is very welcome. At present, under Section 275 of the 1995 Criminal Procedure Act, complainers can be questioned about aspects of their sexual behaviour not forming part of the subject matter of the charge. And in reality, this has often opened up victims to having their privacy violated. The recent legal victory by pioneering campaigner Ellie Wilson against the advocate who cross-examined her will hopefully lead to real change on this front. But we shouldn't be placing the burden on victims to fight long and drawn-out battles just for the right to a decent, fair, respectful treatment in court. They deserve the right to have someone who will fight their corner, and that's what this bill does. And Scottish Liberal Democrats warmly welcome this reform, as well as the one that confirms the anonymity of rape victims. Though, again, I think Russell Finlay was right to pay tribute to the media for the way in which they have observed this in practice. Other aspects of the bill are more concerning, however, and while I don't have time to go into each of these, I'd like to touch on a few that others have already mentioned. The first relates to the introduction of a specialist sexual offences court and a pilot of juryless trials. I recognise the rationale for these proposals and the reasons Lady Dorian came forward with her original recommendations. Nevertheless, I do still share the concerns that have been expressed by many, both within the legal profession and amongst colleagues across the parties in relation to this aspect of the bill. Overturning a key tenet of our legal system here in Scotland was always likely to stir up a reaction. I know the Justice Secretary has sought to respond constructively, but I think it's fair to say that she's been unable so far to allay those concerns. Defence practitioners have made clear their outright opposition, making it unclear how any pilot might work or indeed what success might look like. Postponing the pilots until 2028 may sound like a compromise, but does actually beg the question why on earth Parliament would put a provision in a bill today rather than leave it to a future government and Parliament to decide further down the line if it was felt necessary or appropriate in light of the circumstances at the time. Of course, the Diplock standards for juryless trials elsewhere in the UK include an expanded right of appeal for the accused on matters of fact as well as law. This is a safeguard against case hardening, where judges who have heard it all before begin subconsciously deciding the facts based on their experience of similar cases and not on the merits of the evidence. The UK Supreme Court has reiterated the importance of this safeguard, as indeed did the Dorian Review itself, yet the government proposals only include a narrow right of appeal on matters of law. I understand the Justice Secretary has indicated a willingness to make changes, but this just seems to be a proposal that is beyond salvation at this point. On a more positive note, Scottish Liberal Democrats remain supportive of the proposed abolition of not proven, which, as Audrey Nicol and others have suggested, has had its day. But like many witnesses, and indeed members of the Justice Committee and even the Lord Advocate, were not convinced about the proposed changes to jury size and majority rules. This may yet be salvageable, but I would have to say the government has its work cut out. And plans to create a separate victims commissioner look well-meaning but are misguided. Instead of swelling the ranks of commissioners and ombudsmen, I would argue that if there is resources still available, there's a much stronger case for using that to support existing organisations who at present do invaluable work at work, supporting victims, highlighting their needs and advocating on their behalf. Presiding Officer, the Cabinet Secretary appears to be adopting the kitchen sink approach to justice reform in this bill. I appreciate the attraction of doing so when it comes to the interests of victims and witnesses. But I do worry that the government may be biting off more than it can chew in a single piece of legislation. And for that reason, while I will certainly be happy to take up her offer of continued engagement, as I will with the committee, I find myself very much in the same position as Polly McNeill in not being able to support the bill at stage one this evening.
Thank you, Mr MacArthur. We will now move to the open debate. I call Rona Mackay to be followed by Jamie Green. Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Getting the Victim and Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill to this stage has been a marathon. And as a member of the Justice Committee, I too would like to thank our wonderful team of clerks and researchers and our convener, Audrey Nicol, for steering us through so skilfully to get us where we are today. The aim of this bill is one in which the committee has agreed to improve the justice journey for victims and witnesses and to ensure that victims of sexual and gender-based abuse are supported in a trauma-informed way when at their most vulnerable. Presiding Officer, the testimony we heard from survivors of sexual abuse was shocking and disturbing. Our Stage 1 report highlights quotes at the outset, which powerfully illustrates the need for this bill. From Hannah McLaughlin, "Survivors endure trauma as a result of the abuse that they go through, but having come through the justice system, I would say that I endure trauma not only from the abuser, but from the system that's supposed to provide me with justice. That is not acceptable." From Ellie Wilson, "Survivors of sexual abuse have already had their agency stripped from them, yet they partake in a criminal justice system that further strips it from them. We are treated like outsiders throughout the process." Another witness said she felt as if she was missing during the process. Another said she was so traumatised she couldn't remember her name in the witness box. Presiding Officer, I could fill my contribution with quotes like this, each one powerful and heartbreaking. Last week, a report by HM Inspectorate of Prosecution in Scotland claims Scotland's prosecution service is failing victims in domestic abuse cases. The report concluded better communication with survivors is needed and recommends more victim-centred approach. The Crown Office has said it profoundly regrets that it's not always got communication with victims right. So the aim is clear. Doing nothing is not an option. That's indeed the view of the Lord Advocate and the Lord Justice Clerk, Lady Dorrien, whose review initiated the bill. So as we've heard, the bill's split into several parts, and it's hard to do justice to all of these huge issues in a short speech, so much detail will inevitably be missed, but can be found, obviously, in our Stage 1 report. Yes.
Ross Finlay.
Press my button. I just wonder if the member shares the concerns that others have expressed about there being too much in one bit of legislation.
Ronan Mackay.
Well, there's no doubt it is a big bill, but we've taken a long, long time to scrutinise it and heard so much evidence. I agree, it's huge, but we have taken a lot of time over it. Our committee, despite some differences of opinion, which is natural in a bill of this stature, worked very constructively from the start. And that's why I'm so disappointed to hear that the opposition parties intend to abstain today. What a missed opportunity. On the proposal for a victims commissioner, we heard mixed evidence and the committee was not convinced that the money could not be better spent on frontline services. However, the government has highlighted that victim support organisations wish to see accountability and independent scrutiny of the system, and a time-limited period for assessment will be considered, which I agree with. Presiding Officer, trauma-informed practice cannot be a tick-box exercise. It has to be embedded in the bill to deliver the pace of improvement needed, and it must apply to defence lawyers, in my view, who are currently excluded for very obvious reasons. Moving on to the abolition of the not proven verdict, this is, in my view and the committee's, essential to revert to the reform of the justice system. It's outdated, serves neither the accused or the complainer, and it has to go. But we didn't hear convincing evidence that jury size or majority should be changed, and I'm pleased the government will give consideration to the way forward at stage two. I wholeheartedly support the creation of a sexual offences court. We were concerned, however, that this would not mean a downgrading of the seriousness of rape and sexual crimes, but I'm reassured that this will not happen. Bringing sexual offences in a single forum with specialism and trauma-informed practice is long overdue, given that these crimes have doubled in the past 10 years. But we believe the same level of legal representation must apply, and I'm pleased the Cabinet Secretary will consider how this principle could be embedded at stage two. Similar consideration will be given as to where murder cases with a sexual element will be held. The status of the new court is crucial, and I'm glad that this too will be looked into at stage two. Presiding officer, the conviction rate for rape is consistently lower than from other crimes. Of course, this is partly due to the corroboration requirement, but a 24% conviction rate for single rape case complainers is unacceptable. The Lord Advocate told the committee that in order to improve the justice system for women, radical reform was needed, and I accept that a rape trial pilot with a single judge, or judge with two lay members, or a panel of judges is radical. But I believe it's necessary if we're to improve the justice experience for women going forward. Evaluation, criteria and assessment is crucial, and that's the task of the current working group. Presiding officer, this pilot would provide an invaluable opportunity to gather evidence on rape myths, which undoubtedly do exist, as survivors know only too well. It also creates the opportunity to have written judgments from a judge, a huge step forward for victims. And it's true the committee were split on the issue of juryless trials. It's a bold proposal, but one I believe we should not shy away from if we truly believe in reform. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, today we are voting on the general principles. The government's committed to working with those who have concerns at stage two. Over the past 8 months, the committee has heard evidence from people brave enough to speak out about their experiences. This is our chance to improve our ailing justice system and make it fit for the future. We would be failing in our duty to the people of Scotland if we do not pass this bill today. So I urge members to think, is our current system working for those who find themselves on a traumatic justice journey, or could we do better? I urge you to vote to pass the general principles of this bill at decision time today. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. I now call Jamie Green to be followed by John Swinney. Mr Green.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank members for their valuable contributions thus far? It's fair to say this bill has been on a bit of a journey, perhaps much like my own, from the front to the back benches over the last year and a bit. But of course, it is one of the largest pieces of legislation that I've come across in this Parliament, not just large in its length, but its content, and perhaps even in its controversy as well, because it really has split opinion on many of its proposals. I would say thank goodness this is stage one of the debate. And of course, members will do what they have to as we go through this process. But the fundamental point, I think, is a correct one, and that's that this bill is simply too big. It's trying to do too much in one place. And it's also fallen into that trap that we often see in this place of a bill which has good intentions and many worthwhile proposals contained therein, but also buried in are some major and quite controversial changes as well. And that forces all of us at the end of this process to have to decide a black and white decision of whether we support all of it or none of it. I think that's regrettable, and I think that's a situation that many of us will find ourselves in the months to come. Because really not since 1707 has such a vast statement of intent about the future of Scots law being so publicly made. Some of the proposals in this bill I commend, many of them echo some of my own proposals of the Victims Bill, which I consulted on almost 2 years before the government produced its own proposals. But there are things in this bill that make me and others quite nervous, and it's those that I want to focus on. This bill raised judicial eyebrows with some of its proposals. And I don't think they can be ignored, and much of that is well reflected in the excellent committee report. Of course, we've talked a little bit about the issue of juryless trials. And I think it's fair to say we were having this debate back in 1680, in the first iteration of this Parliament. People like Sir George Mackenzie, the then Lord Advocate, would be relishing this debate and this conversation. You know, Scots law is an evolution. It's not stayed still over the centuries. It is right that we debate reform, but it's also right that we have an academic and informed debate about it. And I'm afraid that's something that these very short debates that we are prone to have in this Parliament is where we let legislation down. This debate needs hours and hours of scrutiny in this chamber. Right back last year, when I did have the justice role, I did raise concerns from the industry, and I raised it not just to be difficult, because that's what people were saying to me at the time when I was consulting with stakeholders. And I said back then that pretty much every defence lawyer in Scotland would boycott a pilot for juryless trials. That, of course, transpired to be the case. And I said back then, and this is an important point, if the accused has no solicitor, it begs the question how on earth the trial could even be a trial, never mind a fair one. And it is that fairness which sits at the heart of my comments today. It's not just myself, not just defence solicitors, who of course are standing up for their clients, but Lady Hale, Lord Uist, Lord Sumption, the Law Society, the SSBA, and even the Lord Advocate and the Crown Office themselves gave what I thought were very stark warnings to the committee. They've been very vocal about their concerns, and I would urge the Scottish Government to proceed with caution and to listen to those learned voices as they follow through on any changes to things such as juryless trials. Of course, there's been some talk about comparisons to European systems, but of course, let's not forget, fundamentally, Scotland has a different legal system. We have an adversarial system, not an inquisitorial one. And it's that important distinction which allows us not to make comparisons of that nature. Part four of the bill is the big part, which is controversial. Of course, the argument against removing the archaic, not proven verdict is an important one. We on these benches, well, most of us anyway, campaigned for the abolishment of that verdict for many years, and it features in our respective manifestos. And it's been a key component of my own proposals, and I'm pleased to see it reflected in the government's proposals. I just don't have time. I wish I had an extra few minutes or a word. I'm sorry, but I'm happy to discuss any of these matters after today's debate. We always knew that the not proven verdict, whilst had a historical place, in today's context, did provide a very clear lack of understanding as to its use and context. And it's for that reason, I think, the committee rightly has said that it must be removed. But here's what I don't get. I don't understand why the government felt the need that the removal of the not proven verdict must go hand in hand with direct proposals to reduce the jury size and to move from a simple to two-thirds majority. Those are things which have been around since the 16th century. And it's really unclear as to where these changes have come from and what evidence underlies and underpins this. Because most importantly, it's what happens to outcomes. And we have heard very little evidence of substance as to what modelling might have. The Lord Advocate herself very unusually intervened in this respect. And sitting as a member of the government, I think she should be listened to. She had profound concerns that this may lead to an increased number of acquittals. And I would say in a bill that purports to be all about victims is a perverse outcome. In the short time I have left, I do want to make two final pleas to the Cabinet Secretary. And that's the two elements that are not in the bill, but I think should be, having despite complaining that the bill is too big. I think we've really had a missed opportunity here, though, and it's an important one. And it will come as no surprise to the Cabinet Secretary that I still am campaigning for the inclusion of elements of Michelle's Law and Suzanne's Law. Of course, there are elements of Michelle's Law which have been improved in recent years, but of course, back then, Hamza Youssef, when he was the Justice Secretary, said to the BBC in an extraordinary interview that he was surprised that the Stewart family felt that he had not delivered on his own promise of making progress, that it was somehow their interpretation of what progress had been made that was a problem and not the lack of progress itself. And I hope that's a mistake that this Cabinet Secretary will not repeat. And of course, Suzanne's Law has all been brought back into focus. In October last year, very sadly, there was a development on that. Edward Kearney, who was the convicted murderer of Margaret Fleming, died in prison. And her family still, to this day, do not know where his sister Suzanne is. He took his abominable secrets to the grave, and too many parents will go to the grave without closure. We have to fix that, and I will work with the Cabinet Secretary if she has a willingness to do so. As I said right at the beginning, and as my own Victims Bill proposes, victims must be at the heart of changes to our justice system, and rightly so, but never, ever at the expense of fair justice and the rights of every citizen of Scotland, rights which are at the cornerstone of our democracy and at the cornerstone of our legal system. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Green. I now call John Swinney to be followed by Clare Baker. Mr Swinney.
Presiding Officer, the purpose of this bill is to address some of the long-standing concerns raised by victims and witnesses surrounding their experiences in the criminal justice system and to act to improve the outcomes for those who are the victims of sexual crime. I do not doubt that every Member of Parliament wishes to see the purpose of the bill succeed, although I also recognise that different members will have different views about how best to achieve that purpose. One of the problems with which we wrestle as a Parliament is that in our current discourse, we often exaggerate the scale and the nature of those differences of opinion. I think the Stage 1 report of the Criminal Justice Committee is a very good example of how to openly air those differences of opinion and to try to find a way to reconcile those differences in a very coherent and respectful fashion. I welcome the fact that all members of the committee supported the general principles of the bill, with some important caveats that the Scottish Government must consider should the bill proceed beyond stage one. That is surely the correct way to proceed. We all want to see action to improve the outcomes in the criminal justice system for victims of sexual violence, but we need to focus in stages two and three about how to get that right. I also welcome the tone and the substance of the Scottish Government response to the committee report. The Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs is demonstrating a clear willingness to listen to different views, and she should be commended for doing so on such a difficult set of issues. There is much to welcome in this bill and to merit our support. The provision to mandate trauma-informed practice in all of the work of the criminal justice system is a welcome step to improve the experience of victims and witnesses in the criminal justice system. If it was all very straightforward, surely that would be happening now. But the fact that it's not means that we need to legislate to make sure it does happen. The proposal to establish a sexual offences court will create the opportunity to ensure sexual crimes are tried in a more appropriate environment, which will embed trauma-informed practice and has been specifically established to improve handling of such cases. I accept the argument that a new court is required to ensure this can be done, as I do not believe that the adaptation of existing structures, which has been argued for by the legal profession, and which of course could all happen today if there was the impetus to do so, and has not happened, will provide the appropriate environment in which this objective can be achieved. The most controversial aspect of the bill is the concept of the jurylless trial pilot. Given the opportunity to conduct trials without the performative approach to jury persuasion, the concern at the existence of rape myths, and the requirement for written judgments to be delivered, I believe this is a valuable intervention to explore how best to try cases of this type. I recognise that in the Scottish Government response to the committee, the Cabinet Secretary is willing to consider measures that may address concerns over this proposal, and that is a welcome approach that she's taken. Of course,
Pauline McNeill.
Very much. I just wondered if the member thought that, given the government have responded with the criteria for what would constitute success of the juryless trials, that if they thought they were successful, does the member accept then that would indicate that we wouldn't have juries for rape cases in the future?
John Swinney.
I think one of the points I very much agreed with Pauline McNeill on in the transactions of the committee was the importance for there to be very open and transparent criteria for the evaluation of the pilot. I think that's an essential. Before we go any further, that has to be on the face of the bill. And if that detail is on the face of the bill, then I think it can give Parliament the confidence that there is an established basis for evaluating what is the performance of this particular measure. And we should, and as the committee has wrestled with, we should consider it the evidence, because evidence is not always in abundance on many of these questions. If Mr. Mara would forgive me, I don't have much time, and there's another substantial point I want to make. I am wholly supportive of the proposal to establish the not proven verdict. The verdict is essentially a not guilty verdict, but it doesn't always come across as that. For an accused, the verdict can leave a stain on their character. For a victim, it can leave the impression that they have not been believed in court. We heard in evidence the unsatisfactory nature of the application of the verdict. I therefore support the abolition of the verdict. I do, however, have serious concerns about how the abolition of the not proven verdict has been linked to proposals to change the size of the jury in such trials and to increase the threshold to deliver a guilty verdict. I am concerned that such changes will make it more difficult to obtain convictions in sexual assault cases, and Parliament would do well to consider with care what the Lord Advocate told the committee on this question at column 15 of the official report of the committee on the 31st of January 2024, and I quote the Lord Advocate: "Fundamentally, however, if we are going to increase the percentage of individuals that we require to vote for a guilty verdict, we will make it far more challenging to secure a guilty verdict in a system that requires corroboration." That's the end of the quote from the Lord Advocate. That is a serious warning that Parliament needs to consider carefully because of the significance of corroboration in these judgments. I understand the conclusion that has been reached by the Government in studying the evidence from mock jury research that in a two-verdict system it is more likely to lead to a tendency to convict. but I am profoundly concerned that we may undermine the purpose of the bill if we establish this connection between the abolition of the not proven verdict and the changes to jury size and composition. I recognise that many people have long campaigned for the abolition of the not proven verdict for entirely understandable reasons and invariably because of tremendous personal suffering and anguish. But I have to say that if it is considered that changes to the jury size and composition are necessary to go along with the abolition of the not proven verdict, I would withdraw the proposal to abolish the not proven verdict. This debate has been advanced due to the courage of victims to speak up, and in committee we benefited from hearing that evidence. Their testimony is profound and should shape the approach that is taken by Parliament. This is the moment for Parliament to undertake fundamental reform to ensure that our criminal justice system addresses the legitimate concerns of victims and witnesses. They deserve nothing less.
Thank you, Mr. Swinney. I now call Claire Baker to be followed by Fulton MacGregor. Ms. Baker.
Thank you, President Officer. I would first like to thank the committee for the report and the amount of scrutiny they have given the proposals. This is a complex bill covering several areas of justice policy. The policies proposed are substantial reforms, and while the committee have been diligent, the bill is very intricate and complex. There are, to be honest, 3 or 4 bills in here, and if the government had taken that approach, there would have been the time to build more consensus in Parliament and across society. Presiding Officer, I'm going to focus on issues around rape and sexual assault cases, including a pilot for juryless trials. As a precursor to these issues, I want to highlight the committee's consideration of ending the not proven verdict and the size of a jury. The nub of the debate is trying to determine what the impact will be and being clear about the impact that is being sought. I agree with Rape Crisis Scotland that the conviction rate in Scotland does not reflect the reality for victims of rape and sexual assault. Firstly, because it is an underreported crime. Feelings of shame, being in a coercive relationship, a fear that you won't be believed, means that this too often is a crime that is hidden or suppressed. And secondly, the low conviction rate. Recent figures show that the 2,176 rapes and attempted rapes reported to the police, only 152 reach prosecution, with just 78 convictions. In evidence to the committee, the Lord Advocate stated, in acquaintance-type rapes, where it's one complainer and one accused, conviction rates are about 20 to 25%. It is a crime in Scotland that you have a high probability of getting away with. Too often it's a crime without consequences for the perpetrator, but a lifetime of hurt for the victim. If we accept that rape and sexual assault cases are underreported crimes, and we accept that to take a case to court there is sufficient evidence to proceed, then we have to accept that the conviction rate does not reflect the reality for victims. For a victim of rape or sexual assault to bring a case to court, it is an extremely difficult process to report a crime, to relive that ordeal through a court case. Organisations such as Rape Crisis Scotland work hard to support victims, but for individuals, making that decision to report rape or sexual violence is never one that is taken lightly. The not proven verdict is unclear. It is often misunderstood by juries, and it is confusing for those who are involved in the case. In rape and sexual assault cases, this can leave the complainer feeling as if they have been believed, but there's not enough evidence, and the accused being left with the stigma of an unclear determination, neither of which is accurate or satisfactory. I agree, however, with the committee, who are not convinced by the need to reduce the size of a jury to compensate for removing the verdict. Some of the evidence to the committee cited a judge being dismayed at the jury's decisions to acquit, which did not reflect the evidence. Which brings me to the consideration of rape myths and jury attitudes. While we may be familiar with preconceptions about how a victim should act and respond, the committee did hear some evidence that it was difficult to definitively say how these influenced juries. I was interested in the suggestion that juries are risk-averse in their approach, particularly when convicting those accused of rape. I do think this is the attitude that is really difficult to change. For jurors, they know that to convict someone of a sexual offence has a significant impact on that person and their family. The complex nature of rape cases, the reliance on witnesses, the proof of consent, present a huge responsibility for jurors, which can lead them towards risk aversion. The lack of evidence from actual jurors means we are relying on the mock trials evidence, which the committee did take the time to scrutinise, and they have expressed some concerns about an over-reliance on this research. I have for some time been interested in different models of prosecution for rape and sexual assault cases. I have been supportive of specialist courts for drug and domestic violence. This bill proposes a specialist court and a pilot for judge-only trials, both recommendations from Lady Dorrian. The Stage 1 report goes into detail about the proposals for specialist courts and alternatives. A parallel court, as proposed by Lady Dorrian, does retain the solemnity of a High Court and recognises the severity of the crime. It would retain the rights of audience and the severity of the crime that represents, though I note the Cabinet Secretary has indicated she will bring forward amendments at Stage 2 to address some of these issues. The argument is made that a separate specialist court will deliver on the other proposals for trauma-informed practice more effectively, but I'm not convinced that is the only way to change that can be delivered, and I would urge the Cabinet Secretary to reflect on the evidence heard. I'll close on judge-only trials. Prior to the introduction of the bill, I have previously raised the cases of Denise Clare and Miss M. In both cases, the women involved ended up resorting to the civil court system to pursue justice. The civil court system is not where women should have to turn. That Denise Clare and Miss M had to pursue that route only demonstrates that the criminal justice system is not working as it should. The committee's split position on juryless trials reflects the lack of consensus on the matter that has emerged throughout evidence sessions and underlines that lack of detail for the plans have made it difficult to reach a fully formed conclusion. In last year's debate on trauma-informed approach to justice, I spoke about particular concerns around rape trials, the difficulties there are in bringing forward cases, as well as securing a conviction, asking how changing to a single-judge trial would improve that situation. I asked what success would look like when it comes to the pilot. Would it mean an increased conviction rate? And I appreciate the Cabinet Secretary has in recent days talked about more information to be given at Stage 2 around this. So what are we trying to deliver here? Is it an increase in the conviction rate? Is it a more effective approach to cases? Is it a reduction in delays and quicker decisions? And the questions of what will be gained from a pilot must be addressed, and this has to come forward at Stage 2. But there will be disappointment from supporters of this approach that it is now that the pilot will be delayed until 2028. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Fulton MacGregor to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is a great privilege to speak in this debate today. And like others have done, I want to pay tribute to my colleagues from all parties on the criminal justice system and, of course, the clerks in terms of the work that we've already done. And I think that members who aren't members here today, who aren't members of that committee, can have faith in the level of scrutiny and the report that's been produced. As others have already said, parts 1 to 3 of the bill are, relatively speaking, straightforward. That's not to say for a minute that there's no issues, but I do think their Stage 1 report was able to pull out the main themes that were raised and have made some recommendations ahead of Stage 2. For example, in relation to the Victims Commissioner, questions have been raised about whether this is the best use of public money, and I know that there is a wider discussion ongoing around commissioners and their role more generally within this Parliament. Also, in relation to trauma-informed practice, this is something that all services should continue to strive for. And although we heard some examples of where it is working well, there is clearly more to do, and we heard that embedding it in legislation should help to significantly speed up this direction of travel. However, Presiding Officer, perhaps unsurprisingly, I'd like to focus my remarks today on parts 4, 5 and 6 of the bill. In terms of part 4, and not proven, we have already heard today the committee did conclude that this verdict can cause confusion and, to quote the report, has had its day. I'd like to highlight particularly the evidence of the campaigner, Joe Duffy, who has campaigned for the abolition of not proven for over 30 years. However, the committee were as a whole concerned about the counterbalance of change to jury sizes and majorities. As you've already heard, we are just not sure about where the evidence for this has come from and therefore could not agree to this in a report. We have real concerns over decisions being made on a 7-5 basis and that it may become even harder to convict, something that John Swinney articulated really well. So one solution for this may be for the government to consider the Lord Advocate's suggestion of a retrial in these such circumstances. However, we also acknowledge that this would be a big change and would require a lot of further work and scrutiny. But if the government do feel there needs to be a balancing mechanism to removing not proven, then work on this may, and I stress may, offer a potential solution. And I do acknowledge that the government agrees with this in their response to that significant work would be required around this proposal. I'll now move on to part five in regarding the proposed sexual offences court. Generally, I feel this is a good idea and could help to deliver justice for victims and witnesses and make the process more trauma-informed. I do think, however, that Pauline McNeill, who has consistently raised a point around a perceived downgrading by taking such offences out of the High Court, and therefore I think we must do all we can to avoid this, even if that is only a perception rather than any legal reality. Presiding officer, probably the most contentious part of the bill has, of course, been around the proposal for a pilot of juryless trials in rape cases. I'm actually quite disappointed by the polarisation of the debate around this, as the committee has worked hard to find a path through this very complex proposal. Although I am one of the four members who agreed that this proposal should proceed to stage two, it was not without some major recommendations to government. We must also reflect that not all survivors agreed with this proposal, with some saying they would have continued to prefer a jury. This was something that was perhaps surprising and unexpected, at least speaking for myself, and that we must continue to take into account moving forward. We have asked for much more information on the pilot to be brought forward at stage two, and the government have agreed to this in the response. We absolutely require information around operational data, the timescales involved, and how the pilot will be evaluated. We also encourage the government to attempt to take every stakeholder with them as this part of the bill is developed and progressed. I'd encourage all members who have concerns about this particular part of the bill to read the committee report and vote for the general principles of the bill tonight to give the opportunity for many of the concerns that we all share to be ironed out through Stage 2 amendments. Presiding officer, I'd like to conclude by speaking about the experiences of my constituent, Anna Christina Siva, who came to my surgery a couple of weeks ago to discuss this bill. She's happy to be named today and hopes that her experiences can help change things for others. Anna Christina was a victim of a sexual assault. The case was heard at the High Court, with the accused being found to be guilty by jury of one sexual offence against her, but he received an absolute discharge. So after going through all the various stages of the proposal, she was surprised to learn that the accused would not even be subject to the sex offender registration, and she's asked me to raise this with the Cabinet Secretary, who may be aware that I have done this last week by letter. More broadly, Anna Christina has been following the bill, and it's the following thoughts that I want to put here on the record. In relation to the not proven verdict, Anna Christina would like this verdict removed, as she feels that juries don't understand what the verdict means, with many people frequently thinking it means that an individual can be charged with the same offence at a later date, or that there could be a retrial for the same offence. And we have to say we heard this a lot from people who gave us evidence. In terms of an introduction of a sexual offence court, my constituent is also in agreement with this and feels that it would allow for more focus on the victim of the alleged crime. And in relation to juryless trials, Anna Christina feels that juries can come to courts with preconceived ideas about how a victim of a sexual offence acts or has acted, and she feels that this does influence opinion and therefore verdict, and feels a pilot may be useful to try and compare a different way. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, it has been a massive undertaking for the committee to produce a Stage 1 report and to get to this point. The aim of the bill is to make things better for victims and witnesses, and that is something that every one of us here should all support. Is it perfect at this time? No. But is it a start for people like my constituent and many other people across the country? I think it is, and therefore I urge the Chamber to vote for the general principles at Stage 1 and allow us to make the necessary changes at Stage 2. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Claire Haughey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Doing justice is about the process as well as the outcome. As a society, we lay a heavy burden on those who have experienced serious crime as victims, survivors or witnesses. We call upon them to recount their experiences, often again and again, in the face of trauma, disbelief and outright hostility. It is a burden that most are more than willing to shoulder, not for revenge or gain, but to prevent others from suffering in the same way. They do a precious service to their community by telling their stories, doing so with truth, with grace and courage. So you would think the very least that the community and the agencies that represent it can do is to treat them with respect and humanity. But far too often that is not the case. We have an adversarial justice system, but in criminal cases the opponents are supposed to be the prosecution, representing the state, and the defence. Survivors and witnesses are not adversarial actors, and yet look at how they are treated, as though they themselves are on trial, with the trauma of their original experience intensified, even overshadowed, by the trauma of the court process. Central to the facts of the case, yet the last to know what is happening and why. And as pawns in courtroom games and collateral damage in performative conflicts. It's no coincidence that all this is overwhelmingly true of one type of crime, a type that I know of all too well from my previous work in the Rape Crisis Network, and I refer to colleagues to this previous employment, which is in my register of interests. The survivors supported by my former colleagues don't only carry the direct consequences of their experience, but struggle through a toxic morass of misogyny, structural violence, and a male impunity that's embedded in tradition, assumption, and myth. The bill before us today is part of a long process of examination, research, consideration, and consultation about these issues. And I'd like to pay tribute now to all who have been part of that work, in whatever capacity, and all who will continue to take it forward. Because yes, the provisions are challenging, not least to long-standing tradition. But the changes this bill proposes are not made on a whim for the sake of change itself or necessarily to follow other jurisdictions. They are made because the evidence suggests that justice, both process and outcome, urgently requires it. For it is not just to have a verdict that judges cannot explain, that leaves defendants stigmatised and survivors traumatised, that serves only to excuse juries from the hardest decision. For it is hard, we know, to convict men for doing what, deep down, many still expect real men to do. It is not just for courts, officers and police stations to be staffed with people who still do not know, perhaps who choose not to know, the effects of trauma and the need to act appropriately. It is not just to have juries so large that not all members need fully to participate. It is not just that abusers in many civil cases should still be able to personally cross-examine those they have abused, and that vulnerable witnesses should be denied the protections that they would receive in other proceedings. It is not just that rape survivors should be questioned about their most intimate lives and relationships without the benefit of independent legal advice, or that they should be named against their will on social media. And it is not just that women should undergo all this, all the horror of reliving their trauma, explaining their pain and postponing, perhaps for years, their hopes of resolution, only to have their truth denied by the stubborn persistence of rape myths, those old lies of inappropriate response, invisible emotion, delayed reporting and false accusations. It is perhaps encouraging that the proposal for a pilot judge-only court is the most controversial and contested part of this bill. While the Tory government in England does its best to suppress even the knowledge that juries can acquit a defendant, such as a climate protector, when it is equitable to do so, it is a relief to hear that their Scottish colleagues have such affection for juries. Because juries do matter, and it matters that they hear the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Any pilot established under these provisions must, I firmly believe, be created and implemented with sensitivity, the active participation of all relevant stakeholders, strict time limitations, and in conjunction with serious and urgent work to address the prevalence of rape myths, not only in jury rooms, but everywhere. I will be voting for this bill today, not in triumph or challenge, but in quiet remembrance of all those for whom it has come too late. Let us do justice for them, for those who wait now, and for those who might thank us in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Claire Hawhey to be followed by Pam Gossall.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. For my speech today, I want to focus on one of the specific proposals within the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill, which I hope has broad support across Parliament, the justice sector, support organisations, survivors and the wider public, that of trauma-informed practice. Members will be aware of my background as a mental health nurse, and at this point I refer members to my register of interest in that I hold a bank nurse contract with NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde. Victims and witnesses of crime need to be treated with compassion. The lasting effects of trauma can stay with people for decades, affecting their day-to-day functioning, their relationships and their ability to effectively participate in society. I'm sure that all of us across the chamber will have heard from numerous constituents over the years of their traumatic experiences in the justice system. And of course, we can't remove all risk of traumatisation from the justice system. There is an unavoidable risk that people are negatively impacted by having to recall traumatic experiences. However, we must take all necessary steps to improve victims' experience of the justice system so they can have confidence in it, which has the potential to improve the quality of the justice process for everyone involved. Presiding Officer, trauma-informed practice describes a way of working with people that recognises the impact traumatic experiences may have had on them and tries to avoid causing them more trauma. Trauma-informed practice is based around five core principles: safety, helping people feel physically and emotionally safe; choice, giving people meaningful choices and a voice in decisions that affect them; collaboration, asking people what they need and involving them in considering how their needs can be met; trust, being clear so that people know what to expect and doing what you say you will; and empowerment, validating people's feelings and supporting them to take decisions. The bill creates a framework to embed trauma-informed practice across the justice system and support a cultural shift towards trauma-informed ways of working. The provisions in the bill include a legal definition of trauma-informed practice for the justice sector to help provide clarity and consistency. It requires criminal justice agencies to have regard to trauma-informed practice in their work with victims and witnesses of crime. A requirement that the Lord President and certain other members of the judiciary have a legal responsibility to take trauma-informed practice into account in court scheduling, and new rules for how court business is conducted in order to try and improve victims' experiences, given they often describe the way a defence is conducted as one of the most distressing aspects of the criminal justice process, and it can contribute to their re-traumatisation. Presiding Officer, the bill has been shaped by survivors and victims and their families, and we owe it to them to listen and to act upon their experiences and concerns. In evidence given to the Criminal Justice Committee, a committee witness, Hannah McLaughlin, said, "Survivors endure trauma as a result of the abuse that they go through. But having come through the justice system, I would say that I endured trauma not only from my abuser, but from the system that is supposed to provide me with justice. That's not acceptable and it needs to change." Similar has been raised with me by several constituents over the years, and a couple of months ago I met with the Minister for Victims and Community Safety to discuss one of my constituents' experiences in the justice system. I'm also to meet with the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs with this constituent next month, and I want to place on record my gratitude to the Cabinet Secretary and to the Minister for doing so. One of the issues raised by my constituent was regarding the standard of communication throughout the court process. My constituent's attacker faced 11 charges, but to avoid going to court, pled guilty to a reduced 4 charges. Now, my constituent as a victim was not consulted on that by the Procurator Fiscal. And I note in the committee stage 1 scrutiny, it looked at the standard of communication from justice agencies. For me, it's clear that the communication has to improve, and I welcome the acknowledgement from the Lord Advocate that she agrees of the importance in improving communication. The committee's report also mentions that legislation is not necessarily required to deliver some improvements, and this is echoed by the Law Society of Scotland's submission to the committee to their call for written evidence, saying achieving a properly trauma-informed system requires more than legislative change. Indeed, we've seen over the past few weeks steps such as the introduction of the pilot to increase access to court transcripts. Victims of serious sexual assault can understandably find it difficult to hear and to process what is said in court at the time. Being able to obtain transcripts where victims can review exactly what was said in court in their own time can help recovery. Additionally, as the report refers to, some organisations are already working to make their processes trauma-informed. Police Scotland, for example, indicated that trauma-informed practice is already embedded in some aspects of the work that they do, while the Crown Office developed trauma-informed training, which has been used by 2,000 employees and 70 advocate deputies. However, Part 2 of the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill Scotland will complement this work and accelerate change within the criminal justice system. In closing, Presiding Officer, the bill will put victims and witnesses at the heart of the justice system. Building on their experiences, these key reforms will make justice services more sensitive to the trauma that it can cause. For too long, some victims and survivors have been let down and ignored by the justice system. Let's make sure that they don't feel the same way of the political system by voting in favour of these reforms today.
Thank you. And I call Pam Gosell to be followed by Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to contribute to today's Stage 1 debate on the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill. In Scotland, as in all parts of the world, the impact of trauma on individuals can be profound and far-reaching. As a proud advocate for putting victims at the heart of Scotland's justice system, I have had the opportunity to listen to the horrifying testimonies and harrowing ordeals that many survivors of sexual assault and domestic abuse have had to go through. Navigating the legal process can be very difficult, re-traumatising, and in many cases it can discourage victims to seek justice they deserve. The system has left complainers feeling isolated, uninformed, and like they are the ones on trial. Prolonged by cumbersome court backlogs, a direct result of an under-resourced, neglected legal system. These victims are then no longer just victims of crime, but of a complex justice system too. Scotland's justice system should protect victims, not add further trauma to their lives. There are long overdue measures in this bill we support, including the abolition of the non-proven verdict, which the Scottish Conservatives have long called for, and anonymity for sexual offence victims. I am also supportive of other measures in this bill, including that which ensures complainers are better supported. Therefore, I see merit in independent legal representation to support the victim when an application is made to introduce evidence about their sexual history or character. On this measure, the Law Society of Scotland did note that while supportive, there are questions of resourcing and practicalities. The senators of the college foresee a surge in a workload for the judiciary, prosecutors and defence lawyers under the proposed changes, warning of potential delays and pre-trial hearing backlogs without adequate staffing and resources. Further delays may only serve to cause additional distress, so I would welcome more clarity on how these proposals will be resourced ahead of Stage 2. I have similar reservation about proposals to introduce a sexual offences court. Sexual crimes rose to nearly 14,900 in the year ending December 2023. So I completely agree that there is a need to deliver targeted, meaningful and enduring improvements in a consistent manner to cases involving serious sexual offences. However, I share concerns with Simon D. Rollo KC, who commented that creating a new court would just be a bit of window dressing. The Faculty of Advocates and the Law Society of Scotland favour an approach of establishing a specialist sexual offences division of the existing courts. I understand that this approach could reduce delays, increase consistency and encourage resolution. Tony Lenhan KC said on this, "It's a struggle just now to resource the courts that are currently sitting. I therefore appreciate that it could be possible to achieve the necessary improvements and address concerns raised through the creation of specialist divisions of the High Court and Sheriff Court rather than the standalone court." Finally, Presiding Officer, I have concerns about the proposals to abolish jury trials. and do not support plans for the pilot. Research has found that jurors do not fall for the rape myths, and when it comes to unconscious bias, as the Law Society rightly points out, everyone is subject to a risk of unconscious bias. With groups such as jurors, the hope is that biases cancel out each other. With a single jury, that cannot happen. The Law Society argue that tackling rape myths has more to do with education than criminal justice reform. And I am simply not convinced that there is evidence to justify what would amount to an experiment with people's lives. In conclusion, Presiding Officer,
Minister.
Thank you for taking the intervention. Does the member accept that the European Court of Human Rights explicitly ruled in 2013 that for a fair trial can be delivered without a jury?
Pam Gosell.
Whilst I hear what you've said, Minister, I think what's important is to deliver a good legislation, and what we've seen coming out here is too many bad legislations. And I think today, I don't even sit on that committee, and I've heard the concerns in here from round the room. So I think it'd be great if the Cabinet Secretary and Minister actually listened to the voices in this room and the voices outside to make sure that we get this legislation right. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I welcome the opportunity to debate any proposals which seek to improve the justice system for victims and witnesses. While there are commendable measures included in this legislation, there are key elements not limited to introduction of juryless trials to which I harbour significant concerns. Adequate resources and changes in practice are key to improving victims' and witnesses' experiences of the justice system. The Scottish Conservatives will always be on the side of victims, but significant amendments are required ahead of Stage 2 debate for this bill to be embedded meaningful change.
Thank you. And I call Karen Adam to be followed by Michael Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The famous quote, "How a society treats its most vulnerable is always the measure of its humanity," cannot be more true when we speak of the vulnerability of the victims and survivors of sexual offences. How we in Scotland treat victims of sexual offences is a true measure of our society and our humanity. And we must go above and beyond to ensure any process is as sensitive and as safe for them as we can. We owe it to survivors who have spoken their truth, often at great personal cost, who sought justice and who've paved the way for others to do so, and to two survivors who right now are seeking justice for the heinous acts of others, and certainly for survivors who, for a myriad of reasons, are unable to get the justice that they do deserve. We owe it to them to deliver reform which will put victims and witnesses at the heart of the justice system while continuing to safeguard the key principles which underpin it. As we have heard, much of the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill has been informed by the work of the Victims Task Force, Lady Dorian's independent and cross-sector review on improving the management of sexual offence cases and the landmark jury research published in 2019. And I wish to put on record my gratitude for the work done here, which ensures that this debate today is not only guided by our own ethical considerations, but by the victims themselves and by reputable actors in the legal sector itself. This bill is ambitious, as has been said, but it's with reforms to modernise processes and improve the experience of victims and witnesses. But I am limited on time, so I'm going to focus on three areas: the introduction of a sexual offences court, the abolition of the not proven verdict, and the extension of the use of special measures to protect those who have suffered abuse from being cross-examined by their abuser. I welcome the introduction of a new criminal court for Scotland, which would permit both rape and other serious sexual offences to be heard within the same specialised court, which is not, at least, not always the case today. Sexual offences are among the most serious crimes dealt with by our courts, and a sexual offences court with Scotland-wide jurisdiction could embed specialism from the outset, supporting complainers to proffer their best evidence and require specialist trauma-informing training for all personnel, judges and legal professionals appearing in the court. It would also allow for more flexible use of available resources, which may in turn reduce delay and increase efficiency in these cases. And this is vital, after all, because the delay of justice is an injustice in itself. I also wish to note concerns that any such specialised court must possess the solemnity that reflects the seriousness of these offences, and it is crucial that any new court is given due gravitas and that every effort is made to avoid any perception of downgrading of seriousness once cases are indicted to the Sexual Offences Court rather than the High Court. I stood for election to this place on a manifesto commitment recognising the strong case for the abolition of the three-verdict system and a commitment to a consultation on the removal of the not-proven verdict. My SNP colleagues and I were not alone. Removal of the verdict was supported in nearly all of the manifestos of the parties in this chamber. What's more, 62% of respondents to the consultation supported changing to a two-verdict system. There is clear and compelling evidence, including from independent Scottish jury research, which was the largest of its kind ever undertaken in the UK, that the not-proven verdict is not well understood by jurors. It can cause stigma for the acquitted and trauma for complainers. This does not serve justice, and I welcome the plans to abolish it. I've listened to the technicalities of this from colleagues today, and I hope for the sake of all, which, and for what I've just mentioned, that a solution will be met to finally come to that conclusion to abolish. Finally, special measures in court cases exist to protect vulnerable people. Whether this is the taking of evidence by a commissioner, the use of a live television link, or the use of a screen to create boundaries between the complainer and the accused, these measures can alleviate the stress associated with giving evidence and ensure that the evidence witnesses and victims do give is their very best and at least as re-traumatising as possible. Presiding Officer, to conclude, I want to mention the award-winning one-woman play, Prima Facie. It's based on how the legal system treats victims of sexual assault. In the final moments, actress Jodie Comer concludes by breaking the fourth wall, speaking directly to the audience and drawing our attention to the statistics. Look to your left, look to your right. It's one of us. One in six men will experience an unwanted or abusive sexual experience in their lifetime. An obscene statistic is that the majority of Scottish women have been sexually harassed or assaulted. We cannot delay this justice any longer. And as a survivor myself, I ask, please vote for this bill. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Michael Mara to be followed by Keith Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary began today's debate by describing the gradual evolution of the Scottish law and justice system. She then identified a range of dinosaurs in need of consignment to the past. And we agree with the premise of a real need for careful reform. Victims' experiences of our justice system can be traumatic and all too often do not deliver the justice that they deserve. Woefully low conviction rates for rape and the plight of rape victims more broadly tell a story of endemic misogyny that continues to plague Scotland. It is right that we consider all means by which to address that culture and its consequences. Yet these benches believe that this moon-sized meteor of a bill is unlikely to provide the deliberate excising of outmoded provisions. More, it's too big and too broad. Professionals believe that it may threaten an extinction-level event for much of the principle and practice of a system that remains in need of modernisation. It makes little sense to undertake these reforms all at once and with as yet insufficient evidence. And the committee has clearly been unable to dedicate sufficient time and attention to a variety of the issues in the bill. And I fear it may be yet another case for this government of legislate in haste and repent in crisis. And that's an all too familiar story. Talk of this government's inability to write coherent legislation is now widespread. Quite simply, there's far too much in this bill. And on the substance of the bill, I am in agreement with the committee, as yet unconvinced on the idea of juryless trials. There is a fundamental governing principle here that it should only be tampered with on the basis of significant evidence, clear academic analysis, and a set of governing principles and protections. A pilot must be based on clear terms, timings, composition, and crucially, the theory of change. What is it that you are actually trying to achieve? The government is clearly in tone and associated policy attempting to increase conviction rates, very understandably. They appear simultaneously to believe that this cannot be made overt, either on the face of the bill or in the direct purposes of the laws. Do they believe that this might prejudice the consideration of cases? That engineering outcomes is itself an infringement of justice? I think these are valid questions, but it makes it pretty much impossible to effectively construct and evaluate the outcomes of a pilot of a juryless trial. And at its heart, I do find it difficult to see why one man or woman, but much more likely a man, might be much less susceptible to performative persuasion than four people would be in a jury of 12. I would also note the comments from a range of sources pointing out that pilot is critically a misnomer. These will be real trials of real cases with real people's lives affected by the outcomes. So Scottish Labour does not support the pilot of juryless rape trials. The legal profession has been clear in its opposition, including the Law Society and the Faculty of Advocates. The government cannot expect such a significant change to the legal system in Scotland to pass without genuine engagement with the profession and by crucially building public confidence. On the establishment of a Victims and Witnesses Commissioner, like the Criminal Justice Committee, Scottish Labour remains to be convinced about the creation of this role and whether it is the best use of the scarce public finances that are available to us at present. The Finance Committee, of which I am Deputy Convener, is currently undertaking an inquiry into the role of commissioners in Scotland. We have seen a proliferation of commissioners in Scotland in recent years, with more seemingly on the way. But as yet, there is no real significant analysis available as to the value or the impact of those roles. What do they actually achieve? What outcomes do they deliver for the people of Scotland? And how do they relate to the work of Parliament? Scottish Labour believes that the resource in question here could be far more effectively targeted to further expanding the scope of independent legal representation. On the issue of not proven and the changes to juries, Scottish Labour supports the abolition of the not proven verdict. And that's been our long-standing policy, and we continue to support abolition. However, the government must recognise that there will be consequences for the justice system. The proposed change to jury majorities from a simple majority to two-thirds indicates there is some form of recognition of the impact that abolition of not proven could have. But the case is yet to be made on the changes to juries, I believe, which include a two-thirds majority and reducing the number of jurors from 15 to 12. Crucially, we have to ask, will public confidence be retained when a jury votes 7-5 for guilty and the accused walks free? The Criminal Justice Committee said they had heard no compelling or definitive evidence presented that would lead them to support such changes. The Faculty of Advocates said the proposals were rash and could have a detrimental impact on the overall administration of justice. This is legislation that is trying to do everything, but in the process it risks achieving very little. With insufficient detail from government to date, insufficient evidence from stakeholders and insufficient scrutiny on parts of the key issues from Parliament, this is not a bill currently worthy of Parliament's support.
Thank you, and I call Keith Brown, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Sometimes when we're having debates like this, we really should remind ourselves of why we're having the debate about these changes in the first place, and we had a very powerful reminder of that from Karen Adams a short time ago. But I think it's also worth mentioning again that, particularly for victims of sexual offences, the latest figures show, as has been mentioned, only 24% of those accused of rape in single complainer cases are convicted, which is a shockingly low figure. And aside from the proposals put forward by the government, I'm not hearing any other proposals that have been put forward just now. And it cannot be the case that we do nothing. I've also heard a fair bit of criticism about the size of the bill. Well, you go and look at the system. See what you can pick out one bit without affecting other bits. It's got to be a comprehensive bill. It's got to address a number of different things at the same time, which perhaps accounts both for its complexity and its size. We've known about this discrepancy in terms of convictions for sexual offences for a long time. This is a chance to do something about that. And we can't forget, and many of us here have spoken to many of the women in particular who have come forward with their testimonies in recent years, waiving the right to anonymity for the public good, to share their experience of a legal system and its shortcomings with the public. And they've also helped create an awareness campaign which has quite successfully highlighted the many shortcomings of the legal system and what can be done differently. And I have said for a number of years now that the system is failing, in particular women. A couple of the points that have been raised. I hear the Tories saying that it's taken a while to get round to abolishing not proven. Well, they didn't take the decades or centuries that the Tory party took, but we have come forward with this proposal in the past, and of course it was rejected by Parliament, and this time it looks like it will be accepted by Parliament. And the most compelling reason, to my mind, is simply the fact that a judge cannot explain, is not allowed to explain to a jury the effect of the not proven verdict. And that can't be good in any system which is meant to be based on lay understanding. I think those that argue we must listen to the Lord Advocate, I think we heard one statement to this effect, we must listen to the Lord Advocate on such and such, but not listen to her. So we must listen to her about the size of juries, but we shouldn't listen to her in her compelling support for juryless trials. Or that the judiciary are against this. Well, they're not. Lady Dorrien is not. There's many in the senior judiciary that are in favour of many of these proposals. Now, all that says is that they're divided, like the rest of us. There are different points of opinion, but let's at least acknowledge that. I would say, in my view, the point that was just made by Michael Mara, the vast bulk of which I did not agree with, but the point he made about commissioners is quite a good one. Now, I supported the establishment of a commissioner. I would just say that if it's to be just established for its own sake, then we shouldn't have one. But if there is a definite role for that, then we should have one for the reasons which have been mentioned. And it has been something that was supported by the Conservatives before. We're now 3 years into this Parliament almost. I'm still waiting to see the Victims Bill that I and others have been demanded to support, or the Domestic Abuse Registration System Bill that we have been asked to support. We should really see these things. These were manifesto commitments. And surely, if we're not going to see them until after we take this bill through, what is the point? Because they could affect the impact of the bill. So I would say it would be useful to hear in the summing up where the Tories are with those two bills which they were committed to bringing forward. I think it's also perverse, in my view, not to support the general principles of the bill. I don't think, and I have to be perfectly honest, there is the slightest chance of the Conservatives voting for this at any stage. We heard from their spokesperson a demolition of each of the six sections of this bill. It's not going to change. We know the approach of the Tories in relation to this. However, I would still say to the Cabinet Secretary to do as she's been doing, which is listening to others, taking on board the points, genuine concerns that are made. Because having shown that willingness to not just listen, but to adapt her proposals, I think she's shown this as a genuine debate. And it would be so much more powerful if you could get to a position where the whole Parliament spoke as far as possible with one voice. But I do think we have to be realistic about the prospects for that. I think we will not get support from the Conservatives. I doubt, given what Michael Mara said, we'll get support from the Labour Party either, although I think it's always worth listening to Polly McNeill and Katie Clark in terms of some of these concerns that are there. So I think it's very important that we do take this forward. It's something that's been wanted for a long period of time. It will make a difference. In relation to a pilot, we should remember it is a pilot. And if we're not going to do what was referred to as being a bold change, what are we going to do? If you don't think a bold change is required for the appalling situation we're now in terms of the treatment of women in particular, in terms of sexual offences, what is the big idea that others coming forward is to do this? Should we not try this? The Scottish legal system has got a very proud history of being innovative, willing to embrace change, and in fact very often leading other systems. Many systems around the world have taken inspiration from our system. And I think this is the chance for us to do likewise. If it doesn't work, and I don't dispute the point that's been made about having properly set out and transparent criteria for displaying that it has worked, if it doesn't work, then we don't continue that. I understand that point. And the last point I'll say in a very... I'm in my last minute, just there, apologies. The last point I would say is that for once, I can't remember before disagreeing with my good friend and colleague John Swinney in relation to the jury sizes. All I would say, the point that he also made in relation to corroboration is an important one. If this is not to take place until 2028, there perhaps is time to take another big chunk. And honestly, corroboration is a huge issue that affects lots of different elements of it. If that was to be dealt with to the satisfaction of the legal system and of Parliament, then perhaps that's something that should drive what we do in terms of a jury size. And it's worth bearing in mind that the entire College of Senators and many people in the judiciary are very supportive of further reforms in relation to corroboration, notwithstanding the very effective reforms which have already taken place. So let's be honest about what we support here, and let's be honest that we do require to have change. And if you don't support this change, at least come forward with something else. Yeah.
Thank you. And we move to winding up speeches, and I call on Katie Clark, up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'm pleased to close this debate on behalf of Scottish Labour and to thank all who have worked on this substantial Stage 1 report, including in particular the clerks and staff involved in the drafting. As has been said, we need transformative change in the justice system for complainers, victims and witnesses. In particular, we believe that the status quo is failing women and the victims of sexual offences, who repeatedly describe their experiences as re-traumatising. The Cabinet Secretary says this bill is needed. It is clear that significant change is needed, but less that this particular bill will deliver the change needed. We believe that it was unwise of the Scottish Government to come forward with so many changes to the system, often without sufficient detail in one piece of legislation. For example, the proposals on anonymity are important but have not been given sufficient scrutiny. One of the main concerns raised by complainers is the impact that delays have in the criminal justice system. The provisions of this bill are unlikely to have an impact on that. It also does not introduce measures such as a single point of contact, which is one of the very significant measures that really could make a big difference. As we all know, many parts of the public sector are already very aware of trauma-informed practice, and legislation itself is not needed to drive that further. In many other countries, complainers and rape victims in particular have access to independent legal representation, often from before they report an incident to the police until after the conclusion of their trial and indeed any compensation is paid. The provisions in this bill are narrow and only relate to legal representation in relation to medical evidence. We welcome these provisions, but believe there is a strong case for further independent legal representation, particularly for rape victims. We are particularly concerned about the provisions on the change of jury size and jury majority relating to the abolition of the not proven verdict. And has been mentioned a number of times in the chamber, the evidence from the Lord Advocate to the committee that the proposals, as they stand, could risk less convictions. This is obviously of particular significance in rape and other sexual offences cases, where there is already very low conviction rates. As one survivor said to the committee, it is like giving with one hand and taking away with another. We are disappointed that the government didn't address some of these concerns in more detail in response to the Stage 1 report. And we believe that it was unfortunate that in the response they sought to rely so heavily on the mock jury research. We do appreciate that the Scottish Government have said that they will give careful consideration to the issues raised in the committee's report. However, would have found it helpful if there were more substantial responses before this debate today. We believe that it is necessary to have substantial changes, and therefore we were very interested in the arguments being put forward in relation to the creation of sexual offences courts. But we are concerned about the lack of detail in the proposals and also concerned about a major reorganisation. We particularly are concerned, partly because of our experience of previous legislation, at the lack of protections on the face of the bill, such as those relating to the rights of audience. We do support the creation of specialist divisions in the Sheriff and High Court to strengthen trauma-informed practice, and we do support specialisation and believe that rules of court need redrafted to take into account the needs and interests of complainers, victims and witnesses. Of course, this does not require legislation. We believe that without the protections on issues such as the right to representation by an advocate on the face of the bill, we couldn't support these provisions. And we hope that the government will be coming forward in further detail as the bill progresses on that aspect.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm grateful to Ms Clark, presiding officer. Can I just put on record that I agree entirely that an accused person whose case is heard in the Sexual Offences Court should be able to access the same level of legal representation that they are currently entitled to?
Katie Clark.
To the Cabinet Secretary for that intervention and look forward to seeing how the Scottish Government come forward with proposals on the face of the bill that would enable that to be a reality, not just for the rest of this Parliament or indeed the next Parliament, but as the decades unfold. We welcome the willingness in the Scottish Government to consider a panel of three judges rather than a single judge. This, of course, was an issue that was raised by the committee for the rape trial pilot. However, we're concerned that we still do not have criteria for such a pilot. I know that the Cabinet Secretary has said that that will come forward, but I think it would have been helpful if the committee had had that during the extensive consideration over many months of the piece of legislation, of course.
Christine Graham.
Does a member not think in principle there are human rights issues with having a pilot where someone's freedom could be at risk in incarceration when months later, in the similar circumstances, there would be a jury trial?
I understand the point that the Christine Graham is making about comparative justice. My concerns are more focused on the bill as it's currently drafted. Isn't a pilot, but it creates permanent provisions rather than a time-limited pilot where we could assess how that pilot had been operated. The Scottish Government say that the conviction rates will not be the criteria, and the Cabinet Secretary will be aware that she was pressed on that point in the committee, but they've not indicated what their criteria will be. Given that I'm coming to the end of my time, I'll say very clearly that Scottish Labour have listened very carefully to the proposals that put forward. We're very aware of the need for transformative change in the justice system. We await the Scottish Government's amendment with interest, and we indeed ourselves will put forward amendments to try to strengthen this bill as it proceeds.
Thank you. And I call on Sharon Dowie. Up to 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's tough to sum up today's debate in the time available. It's been tough for MSPs of every party to discuss all the different elements of this bill in the time available. It's been tough for the committee to scrutinise this legislation fully in the time available. And it's been tough for the government to provide all the necessary details and answers to all the pertinent questions. And we've heard through the debate there's been a lot of them. Can I also take this opportunity to thank the clerks and the research team for all the work in compiling this extensive report. The size and scope of this bill is vast. It's ambitious, and that's welcome. But this bill must be deliverable. It must be effective, and it must achieve the right outcomes. This can't just be an ambitious law. It has to be a good law. We've seen with climate change targets and with the NHS treatment time guarantee that ambition alone is not enough. The law has to be achievable. And during the debate, it's been described by Russell Finlay as experimental. The bill was far too long, clunky, confusing, unworkable. Pauline McNeill also commented about too much being in one bill. Liam MacArthur said it's a very wide-ranging bill. He also then described it as the kitchen sink approach and bitten off more than they can chew. Jamie Green also described how it was too big, trying to do much and too much in one place. But he also mentioned the missed opportunity on Michelle's Law and Suzanne's Law, and also said that victims are at the heart of the system, but we can't do that at the expense of a fair system. Claire Baker also described it as being three or four bills. Michael Mara, a moon-sized meteor of a bill, and little sense to do it all at once with little evidence. The intentions of the bill are worthy. My party's long argued for the justice system to be stacked in favour of victims and not criminals. The underlying principles of this bill are reasonable, and we agree with the purpose of the bill, even where we disagree on the approach or the proposals.
That brings me to our concerns about the bill as a whole. As I've mentioned, the time for scrutiny and debate is small, considering the scope of the bill. We're deciding on legislation here that will be historic. It will make sweeping fundamental changes to our justice system. There is no room for error.
Rona Mackay.
Would the member acknowledge that we've taken 8 months to scrutinise and take evidence on this bill, which is quite pretty unprecedented?
Sharon Dowie.
Thank you for the intervention. I've only just recently joined the Justice Committee, but as I've said earlier on in the descriptions of it, there is a lot in this bill, and it would maybe have been better to split it up into smaller bills. And I'm also concerned in the response that's come back, saying that some parts of the bill are not even going to be implemented until 2007 and 2008, which then leads me to think, why are we passing it just now? Why are we not taking our time and actually doing it in the next session of Parliament? Why has it been forced through just now? Mistakes could have profound consequences. Any one of many of the changes proposed in this bill could overhaul the operation of justice in Scotland. We should be ambitious for victims, but also proceed with some caution given the potential ramifications. If many aspects of the justice system are changed all at once, the unintended consequences could be severe. The consequences could also be difficult to pinpoint and attribute if so much is overhauled in one motion. My party also believes the scope of the bill has contributed to the lack of answers from the government to many necessary questions. The lack of detail in some points and limited evidence base for others could be improved as the bill progresses, but we're concerned by the number of gaps and potential problems at this stage. Moving on to the specific concerns about aspects of the legislation before us. Clearly, it will not be possible to go through every single element of the bill, so I'll focus on those parts where we have the strongest concerns that need to be addressed. On part one, the allocation of resources must be considered more fully. At the moment, not enough funding goes towards supporting victims during and after the court process. The cost of a commissioner could be substantial, and we believe it may be better spent on services directly for victims. And Katie Clark actually mentioned the one-point approach. We also know evidence that the role may be limited in what it could achieve. Russell Finlay commented it was hugely expensive in providing reams of jargon. Liam MacArthur had said it was well-meaning but misguided. And Michael Mara also said, what outcomes do they achieve and what do they deliver? I think some people in the chamber would be hard-pressed to actually tell us who all the commissioners are, what they actually do, and if they're accountable to Parliament. I've never seen them in the chamber, so I think we've got cabinet secretaries and ministers that should be accountable to Parliament. On part two, we're supportive of this section, although... Yes, certainly.
Christine Graham.
For a point of information, the commissioners would not come into the chamber. Only MSPs sit here and members, Lord Advocate, Solicitor General, but they can be called before committees.
Sharon Dowie.
Thank you for that. But again, I would say we have cabinet secretaries, we've got ministers, and they are accountable. So I don't know whether we need to do the finance for another commissioner. We're also concerned that the financial memorandum of the bill does not entirely outline the cost of implementing this section. It seems likely that either further resources will be necessary or the bill would not achieve its goals in this area. As stated by the Lord Advocate in our evidence to the Criminal Justice Committee, the most significant improvement that we can do is to better prepare the victims for the trial process. On part three, my party agrees with the approach outlined in special measures. This section would, however, supersede provisions of the Children Scotland Act 2020, which were not implemented. We consider that a missed opportunity to improve the experience for victims, and we hope that won't be repeated. And to maybe come back in Mr Brown's point earlier on about bills that are going brought through, I would rather the time was spent bringing in a bill that was done properly, rather than, for example, the Children Scotland Act 2020, which was implemented or passed in the last Parliament, now appears to be rewritten and repealed in this Parliament, and going on the response from the Cabinet Secretary or the Scottish Government from our report is not actually going to get implemented until 2007, which is the next Parliament, so I do have concerns with that.
Turning to part four, it's not surprising that this part is the subject of a lot of debate and disagreement. The changes would be radical, they would be historic. On not proven, my party agrees that it's time to leave this unique verdict in the past. But while we can sympathise with the apparent justifications for changing the size of jury trials and majorities, we're very concerned about the lack of evidence to support it. We're also worried that this may be an overstep beyond what is necessary. The other changes in the bill may already have the desired impact of convicting more guilty people. A change of this magnitude, if it becomes more compelling in the future, may be better off in isolation, where its consequences could be seen more clearly. On part five, we believe the current system is right, that a crime as abhorrent as rape sits under the High Court alongside murder. That treats rape with the appropriate seriousness. We appreciate the intentions behind a sexual offences court, but we have practical concerns that it will not be sufficient improvement and it may even delay the process. One of the most common issues that victims of sexual crime raise is the lengthy process they go through to receive justice. We would strongly caution against anything that increases that process further. Do I have enough time or do you want me to conclude? Do you want me to conclude?
You have a little time, right. Mr.
Part 6 of the bill deals with several different points. Our principal concern with this section is the proposal for a pilot of juryless trials. It's been a long-established principle that people accused of serious crimes have a right to trial by a jury of their peers. Moving away from that could have severe unintended consequences. As I stated at the outset, we are concerned that implementing the many seismic changes of this bill at once could make any individual change impossible to evaluate. We also do not consider that there has been enough time to assess the impact of directing juries about rape myths, which only began late last year. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, my party has sought changes to improve the justice system for victims. Several parts in this bill could make a difference. But while we agree with the intent of this bill, we also have some serious concerns. We have serious concerns that the legislation is light on detail, may have unintended consequences, fails to outline the full financial implications, and some proposals could actually hinder the administration of justice. We will work to improve the bill and take a constructive approach towards amendments, but a great deal of changes are needed if the aims of this bill are to be achieved. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary to wind up.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The bill was introduced almost a year ago, and it certainly has been a long journey to get us here today to stage one proceedings. And of course, we've still got some hard miles ahead of us. I do want to reiterate my thanks to committee members, the Criminal Justice Committee, but also the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, as well as the Finance and Public Administration Committee for their scrutiny, as well as all members for their participation in today's debate. I have heard repeatedly throughout this afternoon that the bill is too big, and it is somewhat unusual for a government minister to be challenged on trying to do too much too soon. It is usually the reverse that we hear. But if I could just gently point out to Chamber Presiding Officer that this bill is 68 pages long with 71 sections. There is currently a criminal justice bill with the Westminster Parliament that is 184 pages long, and in this Parliament we've had three previous criminal justice bills that have been far longer, and in particular the 2010. Yes, of course I will, Ms Clark.
Katie Clark.
Surely the point is not the length of the bill, but the number of system changes that are being proposed within the bill.
Cabinet Secretary.
And I appreciate Ms Clark's point, because the point about fundamental reform is needed. And to achieve fundamental reform, we have to be focused on those significant reforms which get to the heart of the needs and rights of victims, and particularly victims of sexual offences. We need to consider all of these issues together rather than in a piecemeal ad hoc reform fashion. And I think that was the point that Keith Brown made. We can tinker at the edges, but that will do little to change the status quo. And I'm very clear, Presiding Officer, that victims and witnesses deserve an ambitious approach, an ambitious approach which can truly impact on outcomes. And one of the matters that we've all heard repeatedly from victims, whether it's in the representation I've received or indeed the evidence given to committee, is that victims often talk about accountability or indeed lack of accountability. And that is what led to calls for a victim and witness commissioner. And the Commissioner will have an important role in holding justice agencies to account. That doesn't mean that we don't also have a role in holding ourselves and each other to account. But I will be bringing forward amendments to strengthen the role of the Commissioner in this regard. And I also want to quote, Presiding Officer, from correspondence that I received this week from Mr Woodburn, and I'm sure Mr Woodburn won't mind me quoting him, because he said, "We have all taken part and pushed for this role in particular because we have not had the role to turn to in the past, and we have suffered because of that. All of our efforts have not been for ourselves. It is too late for us. But everything we have done and will continue to do is for those who come after us in order to help them navigate an easier path through what is an extremely traumatic time, of course."
Russell Findlay.
Yeah, I mean, Mr Woodburn obviously has a very good point, but I just wonder if the Cabinet Secretary has explained to him and others that the Victims Commissioner will not be able to make representation on behalf of victims.
Cabinet Secretary.
Perhaps I could reassure Mr Findlay and say that our proposals for a Victims and Witness Commissioner came from our engagement with victims and witnesses, and in particular through the Victims Task Force. I have a manifesto commitment to deliver in this area, and if I can gently point that there is at least one other party in this chamber that also has a manifesto commitment in this area. Presiding Officer, we all want to deliver a system where victims are treated with compassion and that their voices are heard while the rights of the accused continue to be protected. And as a former criminal justice social worker, I have spent decades upholding the rights of the accused and upholding the rights of offenders while also fighting tooth and nail for the rights of victims. I think surely we can continue to do both. And we need a system that is more modern, transparent and enables public confidence. And the package of reforms in this bill is what will help to achieve this, notwithstanding that there will be changes in the bill as it progresses. Now, our Parliament has long been invested in tackling violence against women and girls. And the bill is part of that agenda. It's not the only part. And I can assure Parliament that we have listened to all the voices and looked to all the evidence. There's no cherry picking of arguments or evidence that suits my particular narrative. We have endeavoured to look at everything in the round. And I think it is naive in the extreme to dismiss the existence of rape myths when you look at 50 studies involving 15,000 participants over decade. Our jury research isn't the only research, but it is one of the biggest of its kind in the UK. And across the chamber, we all recognise the particular challenges in respect of sexual offences cases, and it's simply not good enough for us to shrug our shoulders and observe that these crimes are just too hard to press for justice. And, Presiding Officer, this is our world. This is our world. It's our country's system, and it's our responsibility to ensure that it works for all crimes and for all women and girls, as well as ensuring fairness and integrity in the system. And I will, if I've got time, Presiding Officer, I'll take Mr MacArthur.
Liam MacArthur.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking the intervention? She'll recall that I mentioned in my own contribution the impact of the Smith versus Lees ruling being overturned, and I just wonder what assessment has been done of the impact of that in relation to the way corroboration is dealt with by cases, and in turn the impact that that has on rape prosecutions and sexual assault prosecutions.
Cabinet Secretary.
And as I hope I'd made the point to another member earlier, Presiding Officer, that we are looking at all of that in the round because it's a substantive point that Mr MacArthur raises. Presiding Officer, it is a wee bit regretful that some people have spoken about experimenting. Last week, some members were waxing lyrical about the inquiring minds of the Scottish Enlightenment. And what I want to avoid is us all sitting on a shelf stuck by good old-fashioned Scottish exceptionalism. And in terms of the pilot, it is, of course, a time-limited pilot. I'm already on record speaking to the range of amendments that will be brought forward. I'm really sorry, I now don't have time. I am on the clock. My apologies, Mr Green. But the important thing to recognise is the pilot isn't a button where we can press for change in conviction rates. Each case in the pilot will be decided on the evidence. But this is about having confidence in the conviction rate and that justice is being served. The written reasons that will be produced will explain why cases have resulted in convictions or acquittals. And the biggest reason I'm in favour of a pilot is the strength of written reasons and the assurance and the transparency that they give to both the complainer and the accused. Presiding Officer, I do want to just take this opportunity to once again reaffirm my commitment to work constructively, both across the Chamber and across the sector, in respect of the many improvements that, of course, can be made to the Bill. And if I also point out that it is an indicative timeline that the Government has published in terms of the implementation of this Bill, with the vast majority of the Bill being implemented in year one, which is 2025. Presiding Officer, many of the issues that the Bill looks to address are long-standing. We cannot afford to kick the can down the road, and if we don't act, we will pass the problem to our successors and lose the opportunity to bring about real change for victims going through the system now and in the future. I have asked this before of those who disagree with reforms in the Bill, and I make no apologies for saying it again. If not this, what? If not now, when? It is time for us to take action and work together to ensure that we do not have a justice system that harms, distresses and re-traumatises victims and witnesses, but one that serves them and is fit for a modern Scotland.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill at Stage 1. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of Motion 12560 in the name of Shona Robison on a financial resolution for the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill. And I call on Angela Constance, Cabinet Secretary, to move the motion.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of Motion 12910 on appointment of members of the Standards Commission for Scotland, and I call on Maggie Chapman to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be speaking to the motion in my name as the member of this Corporate Body Appointment Panel to invite members of the Parliament to agree to the appointment of Morag Ferguson and Leslie Stewart as members of the Standards Commission for Scotland. The Standards Commission is part of the Ethical Standards Framework, and its role is to encourage high ethical standards in public life by promoting and enforcing the codes of conduct for councillors and members of devolved public bodies. It issues guidance to councils and public bodies and adjudicates on alleged contraventions of the codes referred to it by the Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Public Life in Scotland. Turning to our nominees, Morag Ferguson has been a solicitor for more than 30 years, spending most of her career in the public sector in both the NHS, Central Legal Office, and a number of local authorities. Latterly, she was head of corporate support at East Lothian Council, with responsibility for governance, people services, HR and corporate communications. Leslie Stewart has worked for the Church of Scotland for over 25 years in Dundee and Edinburgh, serving as an ordained office holder, and most recently she was employed as the Recruitment and Support Secretary and Ministry Support Manager for the Church of Scotland. I'm also delighted to announce that following an open recruitment exercise, the corporate body will appoint Suzanne Vestry, an existing member of the Standards Commission, as the new convener, with effect from 7th of May 2024. I'm sure that the Parliament will want to wish them all every success in their new roles. In closing, Presiding Officer, I would like to thank the outgoing convener, Paul Walker, and also Anne-Marie O'Hagan, who was a member for a while. I wish them both all the best for their future. Presiding Officer, I move the motion in my name. Thank you.
Thank you. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. There are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. And the first is that motion 12922, in the name of Angela Constance, on the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill at Stage 1, be agreed. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.